All right, today we're going to look at Unit 2, Biological Basis of Behavior, and we'll be studying a quick introduction here to sensation. This is typically something we'll talk about in class a little bit because some of these things are kind of the themes of the chapter and why they're important. But you see the image there of my son and myself and my wife having lunch or dinner at a pizza place, and you have to ask yourself that question sometimes. I mean, why am I doing the things or behaving the way I am? What causes my behavior to occur, to happen? Why did I decide, or my family decide, to go have pizza that day? Did we see an advertisement on television that, you know, kind of lit a spark there or a flame that said, ooh, we haven't had pizza in a while, let's go get pizza? Did we smell it, you know, driving by? What prompted the behavior? And that's interesting to be thinking about. As a psychological approach to this, you need to be looking at sensation and perception and understanding that we're really trying to get to the bottom of people's behavior. If there are problems with sensation and perception, the individual is not able to see, hear, touch, taste, or smell things properly, well, that would cause an issue with what we typically see in behavior. That's interesting, and I think you also need to consider that this is an area with addiction that's highly important because your senses are playing into the addiction of whatever it is that someone may be seeking help for. So the bottom left-hand corner, I'm sure that's what you've been looking at here. That is an image from a deodorant testing lab, and a lot of people get pretty... I usually show this in class because people freak the heck out. Like, what in the world are those women doing? I mean, it seems strange, doesn't it? But if you're going to have a product and your goal is to keep people from, being odorific, you're going to need to test that out in a lab. And that's what these ladies are doing. And there are people, like if you've seen the Food Network, who are superb tasters. And so their job is to taste chocolate or taste ice cream or coffee or whatever. And they know, they've been well trained, that their taste buds and their olfactory senses, which is the smell, can really detect differences, subtle differences that other people can't tell or see or taste. So we have five senses. We've got the sight, hearing, taste, touch, and smell. And then the sixth sense, which is seeing dead people, which, you know, I don't know if you want to do that. If you've not seen the movie, it's not a bad movie to see. Not bad for extra credit. So are you influenced by advertisements, TV, radio, print, billboard, and internet? We usually discuss this quite a bit in class. In case you missed it, I think we are very influenced. I think I asked this week in class how many people believe that they're not influenced by these things. And a couple people raised their hand in each class, and I just find it hard to believe. I mean, maybe you have a strong position. Maybe you don't have the opportunity to purchase anything. But believe me when I tell you, they're working on you for later. These marketers and advertisers, it is absolutely in their business model to be sure they can get you hooked on their product. Whether it's McDonald's hamburgers, and they used to have that on the sign, said 99 billion served. That number was flipping all the time, and that's an American institution, and it's grown because they've been able to do a great job with advertisements. If you think of Happy Meals, I mean, kids freak out about the Happy Meal. They want to get the Happy Meal for the what? For the toy. And then, I mean, I don't know what good that does, but maybe it's a good motivator. We'll talk about motivation and emotion down the road here. And learning, maybe you can give that as sort of like a carrot for a kid someday, but you got to be careful because that carrot's not so good for them all the time. Michael Jordan, he was always a Nike basketball player, and now he has his own company, a brand, where he has that Jump logo. I mean, I show that in class. I don't even have to ask who it is. Everybody knows that's Michael Jordan. Most of you have never seen him play basketball. You don't remember his six championships because you weren't alive when he was able to complete them. I mean, but he was a must-see person on television, his best basketball player I've ever seen. And the iPod and Apple, it's a really good example of someone who's marketed well, especially to young people. So, product placement. Product placement everywhere. And I love it because we've got Woody and Buzz, and then he's kind of pointing to the side, and there is Buzz at the computer. And what is it? It's an Apple computer. And on the right there, another cartoonish figure. Have you ever seen the Lisa one, where it's sort of a take on Apple, but it's got the two bites out of the apple, so it's not exactly the same. There's a Steve Jobs-like character. Probably the movie with product placement and advertisements. And do you think you're susceptible to this? You're watching a movie and, you know, there are no commercials in movies, right? That's a great part of it. You don't have to fast forward through commercials or, you know, take a break from your show and, hey, stay tuned, we'll be back. There's no stay tuned, we'll be back. So it's a constant flow and they've got you hooked in. And as we'll talk about in class, you really experience what you're seeing as if it's happening to you. That's why we love to be spectators, because we experience it in some way just as much as if we were doing it. But the Tom Hanks movie there, Castaway, where he's got the FedEx boxes, he worked for FedEx as a company. I mean, they could have decided to make up, I don't know, American Exchange or Packages for You. There could have been a different company name. They don't use FedEx in that movie just because they wanted to use FedEx in that movie. I'm sure there was a financial contribution paid in exchanging hands to be sure that that product was in the movie. And even the volleyball Wilson, you know, if you've not seen the movie, you should check it out. But this guy's stranded on an island, and all he has are these FedEx packages that are washing up on the shore, and one of them is a volleyball made by Wilson. And, I think it's a pretty genius thing. They even wrote that into the movie. The name of the volleyball, of course, is Wilson, and he gives it a name because he's so lonely on the island. iRobot's another one where it just seemed like there were so many ads for Converse, Nike, and McDonald's throughout the movie. But these are not your typical commercials, so you just see them with a great star like Will Smith out there in this movie, a really amazing movie. You can kind of see the robot in the front there. His eyes are moving. They're not supposed to be turned on. They're not supposed to be thinking on their own, but they are. I think it's a decent movie, but the product placement's really what gets you. This goes back all the way to Back to the Future. Now we're in the future, but back then in the 80s, the Nike logo on the shoes that Michael J. Fox wore into the future. So they're basically, Nike is saying, hey, in the year 1984, in the year in the future, way in the future, in 2000 and whatever, Nike is still going to be around, and look how futuristic they're going to look. I would venture to say they look pretty similar to that in a lot of cases. They look maybe more ski bootish, but you get the sense. Transformers, I mean, I don't know how much more product placement you can get with the Chevy here. It turns into Bumblebee, turns into that, and vice versa, he transforms. I mean, that is him. He is a car. And so, I don't know. I mean, that's about as good a product placement as you can get. It's right built into the movie. And then all of the Apple products that you see in movies and television shows. I mean, it's a constant barrage. They've been very, very diligent about that. And let's look at that on the next slide here. Over the past decade, this is up to 2010, Apple was number two as far as product placements go. And it makes sense that in movies, in the top movies, they were appearing in 112 of the top number one movies of the period. Ford beat them out with 144 placements. But Apple's history of movie placements shown below, it's a massive number of movies. These are number of movies on the left. So over 40 movies in 2009 that you could see an Apple product in. It has an impact on people. It really does. And you see Ford here, but I think it's really interesting in the background. You can see, I believe this is TGI Fridays, and there's Dunkin' Donuts. So don't think that like Dunkin' Donuts and TGI Fridays, that was just on that street or whatever. No, this is absolutely done on purpose. I mean, the writers of the movie could put that on a different street if there were signs that they didn't wish to be in the movie. This is all done to try to get you to get inside of your perception, to get your thoughts thinking about, wow, this is a great movie, and subliminally almost, you're witnessing these ads being played forth in a way that they're actually using the product. So I don't think there's a stronger way to do commercials than that. But Reese's Pieces is the E.T. example. It's a really good one. Basically, Mars creates M&Ms, and I guess the original story was Steven Spielberg's 1982 movie, which I'm so surprised how many of you have seen. It's a good movie. It's an American classic, but I didn't think there'd be quite as many. my son and I and wife just watched that this summer. But M&M's was supposed to be in the movie. That was what Elliot was going to lay down for E.T. to follow. But it was Reese's Pieces that ended up in the movie because Mars didn't like the script. And the Mars company made M&M's said, "We're not sure we think this is going to work. We don't want our product placed in a movie that's so silly." Well, it was a huge movie, box office-wise. And, you know, you could think that back then, this is before they really had some idea of how product placement worked. I don't know if it was the science that it is today. So you have to kind of be careful about that. You're constantly being hit with images. So if you think you're not being marketed to, you may have to move to a third world country before that's going to happen. Sensation. And these are kind of fun. These are kind of interesting. But I like using the cats because they have a sense. They really do have a peak of sensation. Just today, I sat down on the bed, shocked the cat. The cat jumped, like, scared to death. Well, their senses are kind of turned up a little higher than most. Especially with hearing. But sensation is the process by which our sensory receptors and nervous system receive information and stimulus from the environment. We're in a constant barrage of sensation, but our brain does a decent job of picking and choosing that which we really need to focus on. Like, I guess if you were really going to be picky, you could be listening and with headphones on to this video and saying, "Oh, I can hear the refrigerator running in the background," or "I can hear the TV program in the next room that my kid's watching." You might be able to hear that stuff if you're trying real hard to listen to it, but even if you weren't, I mean, your brain's probably going to pick out what you want to focus on, and it does a decent job of doing that. Perception is when we organize that information and then interpret that sensory information in a way that's enabling us to make and meaningful objects in the world make sense to us and to understand events. So perception is not always reality, as you can see in the picture at the top left. The picture at the bottom right is another one of those. The cat is, it says, "I'm on your stairs." He literally, his back is lying at the top of the stairs, and you would be walking down the stairs, okay, to get down. There's another level of stairs on the other side, but it's kind of hard to perceive that because you're looking at it and your senses are seeing a cat kind of standing up. If you look at the cat's face, though, he thinks you might step on him, so that's basically what's going on there. What if we could sense everything in our environment? Well, if we could, that would hurt pretty badly. I mean, everything around us giving us information, but the brain does an awesome job of saying, okay, what do I want to pay attention to, what do I want to perceive? If I sensed everything, it would hurt. It would be very difficult. I find this problem to be one that's difficult with MS. My nervous system is not always functioning at the peak level of its abilities. So what I have to deal with is if, like pep rally, it's a great example. We have pep rallies all the time. So if you're going down the pep rally, you can hear the drum beat in the distance. You may be following the drum section of the marching band going down there. When I get anywhere near that gymnasium, I can just feel my entire body start to freak out. I went to one pep rally last year. I stepped inside, and I felt like I was going to start screaming. So I had to get out of there as quickly as possible. I just get overstimulated really quickly. So psychophysics, the relationship between the stimulus and the psychological experiences to them, my psychological experiences to stimuli are not always good ones. I have to kind of, you know, take things one at a time. If you believe that you can concentrate with the television, the computer, the cell phone, the radio, whatever else playing all at the same time, I would argue with you that science tells you that that's you're not able to do it as well. So that's called multitasking. Let's look at a couple ways we can process sensation. There's bottom up and there's top down. Bottom up is basically the analysis that begins with the sense receptors, and it works the way up to the brain's integration of sensory information. So you begin by examining small details and piece them together into a larger picture. Top down is when your information processing is guided by higher level mental processes. This is basically as simple as it can be like this. We construct perceptions drawing on our experience and our expectations. So you're looking at things, looking at the world, and you're kind of seeing the total picture, and you're making a judgment about it, but then maybe you're not seeing the details until the end. The opposite is bottom up, where you're looking at the small pieces, and then they fit into a bigger picture, and then you say, oh, okay, I think I understand this. Another way of looking at it is bottom up processing would be perception, okay, then attention, then memory, then a thinking action. Top down is the reverse, where you're coming down the opposite direction here. You would be looking at it from here and then moving down the screen. You have a thinking action, and then you're going all the way down to figuring out what the sensation or the perception is. All right. In the brain, bottom up is kind of moving from the visual cortex to the front. In the front of the brain is what? It's your frontal cortex or frontal lobes. What's happening here? I mean, think about that for a second. Why would top-down modulation occur here and then move towards the back? Does this make sense to you? Of course, this is the executive level of the brain, the CEO. It's telling us what kind of good decisions we should make. Like, we're working through those issues in the front of our brain. The back of your brain is how it developed. It developed from the back to the front. And visually, we process images straight to the back of the cortex. So, I mean, this makes a little bit of sense to me. If you don't get it that way, just don't worry about it. But to me, I think it makes some good sense. So visual inputs then lead to your attention. This is bottom up. Top down is memories, actions, and perceptions lead to your attention on the small details. So maybe that makes some more sense to you. What do you see in this picture right here? What's the first thing that pops into your mind? To me, and this is, we'll get into some more detail on this in class, we'll see a good video on it, but these are kind of fun little visual tricks, but most people are going to see what? They're going to see, yeah, they're going to see the girl, probably. Here is her her left eye and her right eye, the nose and her lips, and this is her hair. Now, some people are going to see the person playing the saxophone. So that'd be his head and his hair. There's his nose, and all the way down here is the saxophone. There are his feet. So think about which way you would process either piece of information. We looked at the old lady, younger lady in class. This is Gestalt principles, basically, and we've talked about that already in chapter on the first unit. But Gestalt principles are when you're using the whole picture, and then you're seeing the parts from it. You're processing through visual imagery. So let's look at this one. You look at the picture, and I see immediately. This is like a Native American person on a horse, and what you have here is a stream that's flowing down through there, and this person's walking through there. Probably some snow as well. But how many faces do you see? How many faces do you see? So go ahead and pause it here and see how many you can find, and then bring it back. Okay, I'll just show you a few of them. There's a face here, and that looks like a Native American face. There's one over here, the left side. There's another one. Here's another one in the rocks. I'm just skipping through this really quickly. There's a bunch of them. There's one here as well. So, are you using bottom-up or top-down processing as you look at this? Think through that. It's something we'll discuss probably in class some as well. But does this make sense to you? Are you seeing the whole thing, something you're familiar with, you know, horseback, Native American riding through this picture, you're seeing the whole image, and then you find the finer details. Is that top down or bottom up? Let's flip back and see. Whenever you're doing, you have a higher level mental process, we draw on our experiences and our expectations, and then we start to develop the small details, that's top down. Bottom up is when the brain's integration of sensory information takes place. We piece together the smaller details and then we make them into a larger picture. So what do you think is happening in this image? To me, it is definitely top-down processing. If you look at it this way, you're not seeing those individual faces initially. You're seeing the whole picture. You don't even know that there are little faces mixed in there. And it's not until maybe your attention is drawn to it, or if you've seen it before, then you've experienced it before, and then you see it right away. So that might be a good example of top-down. Psychophysics is this quantitatively investigative approach where you're going to look at the differences between the physical stimuli and the sensation and perceptions that they affect. Fechner coined this term, the making connections between the matter and the mind in public and private ways. And Wundt looked at the structuralism. Weber looked at signal detection theory. And we'll look through a couple of those here in a minute. But we're thinking about light, brightness, sound, volume, pressure, weight, taste, sweetness. Those are just some ways to measure and think about the psychophysical approach. Absolute threshold is for a specific type of sensory input. It is the minimum amount of stimulation that an organism can detect. So the minimum stimulation needed to detect a stimulus 50% of the time. It's just the term and just what they decided to go with here. There are a lot of good examples for this. Maybe it's when you're watching television, like these two kids are watching it here, and their attention, their absolute threshold, is going to be maybe a little bit different than other people, right? They're this ability to perceive sound. If mom's calling them for dinner, maybe they're not so much hearing her. If mom's calling them to go to ice cream, now their interest is peaked. They somehow hear that. So there's different ways to look at absolute threshold. Then there's the difference threshold, the minimum difference that a person can detect between two stimuli required for detection 50% of the time. This is also known as the just noticeable difference. So in my example here, you have across the bottom from left to right, very expensive headset to a pretty decently expensive and also high quality headset there in the middle to the iPod earbuds, which are, I don't know, they're your run-of-the-mill normal headsets. There's not a whole lot of magic to that. They're ubiquitous. You see them everywhere. Is there a difference for you? Can you detect the difference in the sound quality? Some people probably, they're audiophiles. They're really into that. They can detect and hear the differences pretty well. But if you can't really tell the difference, there's not that just noticeable difference. I don't know if this is making sense to you, but if a person can detect between two stimuli required for detention 50% of the time, meaning that if you had on the iPod earbuds, could you notice the difference in the quality of it compared to something that's much more expensive or maybe something just a little bit more expensive? Another way of looking at this is that we have a very sensitive absolute threshold for vision. So only 3 photons on a single receptor across a moment of time will trigger detection. That is pretty amazing. Like in the distance, we can see a flickering candle miles away. And that sounds crazy, like no way. But if it's a clear night, it's totally dark, our ability to see is really very strong. It's probably our best sense. Our other modalities are sensitive, though not as sensitive as some other animals, like, for example, sharks. Sharks can detect a single drop of blood in thousands of gallons of water. And this is probably why people are so fearful of sharks, the other reason because of all the movies about them. Open Water is a movie that was kind of not a true story, but taken to the big screen and to scare your pants off. I think it was a pretty good movie, very artistically done. But some of you here in Texas may understand how I am feeling about this. I'm not from here, but when I first came here and I ordered a sweet tea, I tasted it and almost like fell over. I was like, wow, I did not order a large cup of diabetes. What in the world's going on here? But we can taste sugar, or we can taste a teaspoon of sugar in only 2 gallons of water. Some people, though, need a lot of sugar in their sweet tea. I'm not quite sure why. This is a link out there to Sensation and Perception video. This is kind of interesting. We didn't have a chance to see it this year in class, but she does this thing with her hands like constantly. And it's I can sense and perceive that that's a problem for me. But the quality of the video on this series called Psychology 101 is very, very good. So I challenge you, if you're looking for something else to kind of latch on to learn a little bit more about psychology or to get prepared for the AP test for AP students, that's a good thing to do. Signal detection theory. This is where you predict how and when we detect the presence of a faint stimulus or signal amid the background stimulation of noise. This assumes that there's no single absolute threshold because it's different for everybody. But we detect stuff based on our experiences, our expectations, our motivations, and our fatigue level. And you can get me pretty good when I'm fatigued, which is usually. But the perceiver's response there at the bottom, these are your hit and misses on signal detection. And a lot of times, especially in the AP test, they'll say something about hits on signal detection, how you measure if there's a correct response is present. So there's a false alarm where you say yes, but if there's nothing, and when you say no and it's present, that's a miss. A correct rejection, of course, would then be when there's a no and it's also absent. It's kind of similar to null hypothesis in a way. And you see Charlie Brown there. He absolutely has trouble detecting every year, every fall, that Lucy he thinks she means business. This is on. She's going to hold the football this year. He's going to get to kick it, and every year she pulls it out. So this is a quick little graphic that shows you Charlie Brown's signal detection area here. Where Chuck's criterion is, as of right now, is the brown area. So it's hard to see here, so it's this area here. And what it means is it does not exist. He's not detecting it. Where you would think his criterion should be is right here down the middle. And that's between where these two intersect, where Lucy is not going to let him punt or kick, and where Lucy is going to let him kick. So where those two signals kind of, or two lines kind of cross. It's a way of looking at it, and I doubt that would be on the AP test, but it's interesting to consider. So sensation threshold, this gives me a chance to talk about dogs, right? Weber's law, or Weber's law, is to perceive as different. Two stimuli must be different by a constant minimum percentage. So like light intensity, 8%, weight, 2%, tone difference, 0.3%. So a constant minimum percentage. Sensory adaptation is a diminished sensitivity as a consequence of constant stimulation. And maybe you would be able to sense, understand this one better if you're thinking about like when you eat something and right away you can taste really a strong flavor or spice in something. But then you eat enough of it and it seems like it's not as bad. Well, maybe you're sensorily adapting to that taste. So Weber or Weber's law here, to perceive a difference between two stimuli, they must differ by a constant percentage, not a constant amount. So it's the percentage that is important, not just the amount. So a good example is that Weber found that JND, the just noticeable difference between two weights, was approximately proportional to the mass of the weight. So if 105 grams can be distinguished from 100 grams, the just noticeable difference is 5 grams. If the mass is doubled, the differential threshold also doubles to 10 grams, so that 210 grams can be distinguished from 200 grams. Does that make sense? Well, let's look at this in real life. Weber's law is that difference thresholds grow with the magnitude of the stimulus because the difference is a percentage of the magnitude of the stimulus, not a constant amount. So what are some examples that you could think about in your everyday life? Kind of pause this and consider it. Think about different ways that you could be using your senses and then have the difference threshold come into play. And then I'm going to look at some of them here in a second. Okay, Weber's law experiment. If you had two envelopes, one with two quarters in the envelope and one without any quarters in the envelope, would you be able to detect the difference? I would say yes, no question. One's heavier because it has two quarters. One doesn't have the two quarters. However, you put those two envelopes in a pair of shoes, like one shoe apiece. You pick up the shoe, is there going to be a detectable difference? Could you notice a difference? And I would venture to say you would not be able to, because now the weight has increased that you're using. You could do the same thing with a book. Like if you used a flat book, your psychology book and your history book, or two psychology books would be a better example, and then you put the envelopes on, the one with two quarters, you would not be able to tell which one. You know, and this kind of makes some sense, but the principle is the difference threshold grows with the magnitude of the stimulus. Here's another one, just in a different practice here. You make $5 an hour, which isn't enough, and you get a 25 cent per hour raise. Will it be noticeable? Well, not as noticeable as if you say, but at $10 an hour, you may need 50 cents to notice or really see the difference. So if you do notice that, I mean, $5 an hour isn't much, you're getting $5.25, you're gonna see a difference. But the more you make, the bigger the jump you may have to be able to sense or feel the difference. In car sales, after a sales customer has purchased the car, is he really gonna notice the $500 stereo? I mean, that's a way of kind of throwing in or you know, earning more from a purchase than what someone's really going to be able to tell down the road. Like the stereo that was $500 cheaper, are you really going to know the difference? Hard to tell. But after drinking a tea with lemon, a grapefruit will not taste as sour, but after like eating a roll or a piece of bread, it will taste especially sour because you don't have that... the difference is not going to be jumping out there. Here's a good one. After holding salt water in your mouth, it'll taste less salty, okay? And drinking fresh water afterwards will almost give it a taste of sweetness, which is very strange, but it's because you're now noticing this absence of salt. Subliminal stimulation, we'll cover this pretty quickly. I usually do this in class some, but below one's absolute threshold of conscious awareness, there you have the ability to kind of be tweaked, or you could be motivated to do something because of this subliminal stimulation, which you're not really even aware of. So if you look at the top right corner, top of a Coca-Cola can, you don't really see anything at the top image of it, but just below it, they've outlined it a little bit. Can you see that this is her hip and this is her foot? This is her hair along the side. Now, would you be aware of that? Probably not, but maybe somewhere subconsciously would you be? I don't know. How about the FedEx logo? This is a really good one. Is the FedEx logo hiding a subliminal piece of information for you? Of course it is. A lot of you know this. There's that arrow right there between the E and the X, and it's moving forward. Well, it's like a Federal Express ad here. I'm embedding this product in my presentation a couple different times. So maybe FedEx should be paying me some money. But are you subliminal? Are they subliminal enough to have an effect? Well, subliminal ads do affect you and can be important, but they're not in other ways. So what's the deal here? Slide studies, and they do this where they would show people looking at different things, and they would put in there a very quick subliminal word. It showed a primed response, so you could get some emotional reactivity to that. But the results are subtle, meaning they're not dramatic, they're very small, and they're fleeting, which means they're not going to last very long. So you might be able to get somebody to change their opinion of something or purchase something because they've just seen it and they're just about to purchase it and they really want it anyway. And you've pushed them to that point where they will make the purchase. This is a really good ad to describe it. I'm not going to click on it here because it's just harder to get it to work with the video embedded. But you can, and within the notes, if you want to see the full ad for yourself. During the 2000 U.S. campaign for president, President Bush's campaign released an ad. And it kind of did this, and I'll play this part of it for you. Within the ad, they were talking about, I can't remember, prescription drug plan. And they used the words, bureaucrats decide. Basically, that you're not deciding, you're not the decider, which is interesting because he used to call himself the decider, George Bush. That was a George Bush joke. No, sorry. I don't really care who you vote for. Can't vote for him anymore anyway, but or Al Gore for that matter. But this election campaign was really, really close. I mean, it was decided in Florida, and it wasn't decided for like a month later. It was bizarre. Was this subliminal ad, which popped up the word rats, where there was bureaucrats and rats jumped up there, was that something that motivated voters? I mean, I'm not really sure, but then there's, you know, subliminal messages. I will not plant subliminal messages. Maybe Al Gore was a subliminal. Oh, see, the Democrats are doing this too with the Simpsons. I'm not sure anybody votes who watches that, but can you see the subliminal nature of these ads? Pause the video, kind of jot it down in your notes here. Tell me where you think the subliminal image is, and come right back here and I'll play it in 1 second. Okay, here are the answers. Amazon at the top left. They sell everything from A to Z. See the arrow pointing that way? It also makes what? A smile. So let's look at Tomberlone. I believe this is a chocolate and it's sold in like the Swiss Alps. Tomberlone means bear. It's the name of a town. And you can kind of see the bear here embedded in the side of the mountain. Sony's Vaio is the hardest one for people to get usually, and so you might not know this one. The Vaio was a line of electronics and computers. This was signifying, the V and the A is signifying analog to ones and zero, digital. So we give you everything from analog to digital with entertainment. Tostitos, most of you probably are familiar with. Here's the bowl of Tostitos salsa and the chip. And then there's two people on either side who are dipping the chip in there. Most people know this or see this, but some may not. Zurganic, I guess it's called Zurganic. You've got the eagle, and of course you see the, I guess that's a Mustang. Yeah, and a wolf on either side. So they're showing you an organic or zoorific. I don't know what they're showing you. Car search, do you see what car search is? Of course, it's a key. I've had some students who never notice that, but I think that's pretty obvious. It's a key. At the top, two kids who are holding hands, and there's a dove of peace in the center. Here's a good one. Yoga Australia. Do you see Australia? Australia is here. Right there, the outline of Australia. Baskin and Robbins, I never saw this one. And who knows why? Maybe my experience was it was always in a B&R. I never really saw that it was anything different. But the 31 flavors is right there in the middle. I don't know why I never saw that one, but I had a lot of trouble with that. And the bottom one's Hope for Africa Initiative. You've got an adult who is looking down here at a child, and then that's Africa that is outlined there. So Hope for African Children Initiative, adults helping children in Africa. Selective attention. This is some more Gestalt stuff. It's focusing of conscious awareness on a particular stimulus. Like, do you see that X in the middle there right away? That's one thing. You could focus in on that. What do you see? Do you see an arrow, a series of arrows down here? Oh, there's an arrow, there's an arrow, there's an arrow. Or do you see a three-dimensional box where the outline is drawn right here? A lot of people initially will see this three-dimensional box even though most of the lines aren't there. This is Gestalt principles, where we are going to draw in what is missing. Our brain does this. It's amazing at doing it. And so subliminal ads like these work because of that. Or not ads, like subliminal. They're just messages. They're neat messages, I think, for logos. An example of selective attention is the cocktail party effect, and everybody's aware of this. I'm not so sure you know what a cocktail party is, but these are the old 1950 parties where people would sit around and have a cocktail and a drink or whatever. I don't think this is as popular as we used to have or see anymore. But you've probably been at a party or a Super Bowl party or somebody's birthday party, and there's a million people there. It's very crowded, and you're standing there talking to one person who you're very interested in. Do you hear everything that's going on around you, or do you hear that one voice that you're interested in? It's pretty simple. You focus in on the one voice. So selective attentioning is what that's referring to. Homer Simpson at the top there is one of my favorite episodes. It's really hard to find anything on this though, because it's so old. But he goes to church. It's a Sunday. He's listening to the football game in his headphones. You can kind of see the headphones here. And the pastor stands up and he says, "Praise the Lord." And Homer Simpson jumps up and says, "Woohoo, yes!" Because I think the Packers just scored a touchdown or something. So everybody thought, wow, Homer really gets this. He's really into it. But that's not what was going on. Sensory adaptation. This is an older television show. I'm not even sure if it's on anymore. Might be. But What Not to Wear. This is a good example of this. Diminished sensitivity as a result of constant stimulation. Meaning we don't detect that what we're wearing is kind of crap. But this isn't crap. But we don't detect it if you're wearing that same old shirt that looks bad on you now. Because you're used to it. But someone else who sees you for maybe the first time they meet you, they go, whoa. So this is where our senses are more involved or more evolved to detect changes in physical energy. If something's staying the same, we don't notice it. Or if something's changing in a very small way. Like, you may think your room isn't a mess, but your parents are certain that it is. And they want you to clean it up. And you're like, well, it's not that messy. Yeah, well, there's clothes all over the floor. Well, there's this here, there's that there. You've got mold growing on the ceiling. Maybe you need to clean your room. But you might not notice it if it's slowly happening over time and you are not detecting that physical energy of that, because it's not changing too fast or rapidly. If there are no changes in our physical environment, we adapt to the static energy levels, then we cease to notice the changes. And this is sensory adaptation. So we don't perceive the world as it really is, but as it is useful for us to perceive. And what we see and what kids see is very different. We see a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, they see fine dining. What we see is a hallway, they see a slip and slide. What we see is a romantic comedy, and what they see is blah, you know. So that's one way to look at it. And here's one you could pause and look at, but this is a little bit older now because I don't know that people are really using BlackBerries much. But how the typical iPhone user sees herself and sees other people who use BlackBerries and how she's seen by Android users. I think this is a pretty funny one. But it is an example of this this perception, and we have a self-perception as well. Perception is not reality. You know this if you've ever seen an ad for a hamburger, and then you've got the real thing. Oftentimes, the hamburger is bigger on the ad or the picture than it could physically be to fit in the box. And they've done some of the stories on that as well. We looked at Darren Brown in class, quite possibly. He does some really good things with predicting people's behavior and also with subliminal things. And this is a quick video clip about him talking about appearance and reality and how he does some of the things that he does. So I'm going to not play that, but you can play it within the video if you want. And in his book, Tricks of the Mind, he says, "I'm often dishonest in my techniques, but always honest about my dishonesty." And he uses a mix of magic and suggestion. Magic being not that it's magic, but that he's able to do a trick and an illusion. Suggestion, psychology, misdirection, and showmanship. So I find that interesting. He's an interesting guy to look at, but he does use a lot of psychological ploys and tricks. Hypnosis is one of the things he can do well, and we'll kind of talk about that a little bit in the next part after we're done with Unit 2. We'll go to Unit 3 and talk about consciousness. So that's something we'll come up with here in a little bit as well. So that's sensation introduction. I'll be back in a few minutes with another look here. We're going to look at both sight and hearing really in an intense way. More intense with sight and vision, a little bit with hearing in the ear, and then some with taste and smell kind of go together. They're almost like one thing. And then touch is probably the least of the important ones for the psychology test and AP test, but I think it's an important sense, but it's maybe not our most important sense in terms of getting information from the world. So that's the introduction. We'll see you next time. Don't forget to be awesome.